I'd like to invite Pam to come forward and light the celebration candle. Just a quick little bit of housekeeping. If your cell phone's on, please turn it off. Bathrooms, if need be, are downstairs over in this corner. And that's all I can think of at the moment. The Lord be with you. Let us join together reading our call to worship. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Know ye that the Lord, he is good. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Let us come together in spirit of prayer. Holy God, whose ways are not our ways and whose thoughts are not our thoughts, grant that your Holy Spirit may intercede for us with sighs too deep for human words. Heal our wounded hearts made heavy by our sorrow. Through the veil of our tears and the silence of our emptiness, assure us again that ear has not heard, nor eye seen, nor human imagination envisioned what you have prepared for those you love. Through Jesus Christ, the firstborn from the dead. Let us join together using the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If you would please stand and turn to hymn number 545 in your blue hymnal, we'll be singing He Leadeth Me.
Thank you.
Please be seated. I'd like to invite Valerie to come forward.
Ecclesiastes 3, verse 1 to 2, 4 through 7, and 13. To everything there is a season, and a time everything under the heaven.
A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up which is planted. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get, and a time to lose. A time to keep, and a time to cast away. A time to render, and a time to sow. A time to keep silent, and a time to speak. Every man should eat and drink and enjoy the good of all his labor. It is the gift of God. Uncle Dick.
Timothy 4, verses 6 to 8. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing.
Oh, I am sorry.
From the Good News Bible, John 14, verses 1 through 6. Do not be worried and upset, Jesus told them. Believe in God, and believe also in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house, and I'm going to prepare a place for you. I would not tell you if it were not so. And after I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to myself, so that you will be where I am. You know the way that leads to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way to get there? Jesus answered him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except by me.
If you would please stand and turn to hymn number 546 in your blue hymnal, we'll be singing Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
Please be seated. I'd like to start off with, I checked with Ruth and the family, I know this is Kenny's time, but I also want to ask you all to keep the Congregational Church in Spencer and the members of that church in prayer. I don't know if you've seen it, but they were devastated by a fire, completely destroyed the building. Kind of makes me appreciate what we have here. So please, I can actually share some news with you. It is a yoke church, so they do have another church that they're able to attend. It's not the end of the world for them, but it is heartbreaking. So please keep them all in prayer that they can get on their feet and move forward. Thank you. We gather this morning to remember and celebrate Ken Lowe's life. Ken now resides with God. As our reading in 2 Timothy is alluded, Ken has fought the good fight. His life is testimony to that. However, I like the last verse. I don't know if you caught it. And I think Ken might be a little bit hesitant to say it because it starts off sounding a little bit boastful. But it doesn't end that way. So I want to bring this out to you. It says, "There is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me that day." But then it goes on to say, "And not only to me alone, but unto all them also that love his appearing." So I just wanted to make sure that you get that. We all get to be a part of that someday. Ken did God's work. He served its community, his church, his family. I was fortunate enough to witness Ken's love for his family. I don't know if you noticed when you came in, it fit. There's a picture of two holding hands. So when Ruth called me to let me know that Ken's time was coming near, I went to the hospital, and there Ken was. He was alert. And he took my hand and held it. But the cool thing is, then he took his children's hands and their spouse's hands. He held them, and then he brought them together. I'm sorry, but that's cool. I'm not sorry. That was cool. That was like, here's my blessing. I love you guys. Ken's concern for his community, immediate and extended family, was clearly visible. By his service to and concern for others, his actions quietly and consistently preached God's love to us all. God doesn't promise us that we'll be spared the pain of mourning a loved one's death. Even Jesus experienced anguish at the burial place of a dear friend. What Scripture does promise is that our grieving will be different because it's tempered by hope and belief in a loving God who will watch over us for all eternity. In God, we find the assurance that in death, just as in life, Ken belongs to God. Even in the pain of our loss, hope wells up inside us to exclaim, "Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting?" The Scriptures tell us God has appointed for everything a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. Throughout the many years that God blessed Ken's family and friends by his presence, he shared with them all the fullness of human life. He shared the joyous times of laughter and, yes, the times of sorrow. He knew the grace of God's gift that all should take pleasure in their toil. Ken toiled. He did a lot. I think we might hear about some of that today. Even in the times of greatest struggle, God's Spirit gives us divine love and grace to carry us along life's path. The past, with its memory of joy and beauty, provides us with the hope to face the future. We can know the peace that comes from the knowledge that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it. The beauty part is nothing taken from it. Because Ken was given to us by a loving and generous God, the best thing we can do today is be thankful. Ken gave us something good, something precious, something valuable. He gave it to each one of us. He gave us himself in all that he was. This is an opportunity for us to say thanks to God for giving Kenny life on this earth and for giving him everlasting life. The Bible tells us that God sent his son Jesus to prepare a place for us in the Father's house, a house with many rooms, rooms for all kinds of people. Ken has now entered that place where there's no more illness or crying or pain or dying. We can be thankful that his life didn't truly end when his body failed. Ken continues on in the house of his heavenly Father. Ken continues on in you. Because of God's goodness, Ken is dwelling in the house of the Lord forever. So this day, we give thanks for the gift of Kenny's life and to thank God for his gift of everlasting life. But it isn't a day free of sorrow or sadness. We're grieving the loss of a precious friend, husband, grandfather. We're grieving a precious life. And we're feeling a mixture of emotions. I ask that you take all these emotions and turn them over to God. Offer up your gratitude and your grief, your sorrow and your joy. Take this moment to honor Kenny and to thank him for the love and goodness he has extended to so many. We can find peace and serenity only when we turn our lives over to God. We can walk safely through the valley of the shadow of death only when we discover that the Lord, our good shepherd, is walking beside us. We never have to walk alone because our Lord is by our side. In every time, place, and situation, he's a God of grace and love and excessive generosity. Kenny served this town as a firefighter and on various boards. He did things not for his personal glory, not to say, hey, look at me. He did all these things and much more because he was making Rutland a better place for himself, his family, and his community. Ken has fought the good fight and has finished the race. Well done, good and faithful servant. You have earned your rest in Christ. Amen.
O Lord, support us all the day long of this troublous life, until the shades lengthen and the evening comes, and the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in thy mercy, grant us a safe lodging, a holy rest, and a peace at last. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank God I have her.
The first thing I think of when I think about Grandpa, thank you, is how special he made me feel, always. He was a quiet, steady presence in every room. Not usually the center of attention, but always the center of gravity, like a star. At every game, he was there. At every event, he was there. Every family dinner, he was there. He was objectively one of, if not the most important person in any room. But what was special was knowing that you were the most important person in the room to him. And he always had a smile that was just for you, to let you know. Several years ago for Christmas, I painted a favorite quote for each of my family members. And each quote was meaningful to me in some way and represented something I loved about that person. The one I chose for Grandpa was by Roald Dahl, "It's impossible to make your eyes twinkle if you aren't feeling twinkly yourself." Grandpas are the best at being twinkly because, like stars, they age. As they age, they twinkle brighter. And when a star dies, their light doesn't go out. They go on twinkling long after they're not really there anymore. Something that struck me the most about last weekend was how normal it felt to be together. It was sad, but we were still just us, and Grandpa was still just Grandpa. His eyes didn't even need to be open to twinkle. Even on Monday, after he was gone and we were all together, all of us at the same time for the first time in months, it just felt so normal. And that's not because his absence doesn't matter to us, it does. But I think it's because he was very good at being twinkly. And that light doesn't go out just because he's not here. When you twinkle, you exude uniqueness and authority and kindness in a way that draws people to you, but doesn't force it on them. It means always sharing in your happiness and living widely and deeply. It's building a family around you that doesn't need you to physically be there in order to be okay. It's leaving behind a legacy of love and hard work and a little mischief. It's a smile that's just for you. It's just being a grandpa, and I'll miss that most of all. Thank you.
Thank God we have her.
As you may recall, Kenny's stories, first of all, I want to thank the family for trusting me with this job. And in case any of you don't know me but do know Ruthie, I'm her sister. As you may recall, Kenny's stories were always long. In keeping with that tradition, the family put together a little something for this service. This is it. I hope you packed a lunch. How do we begin to honor the life of our mother's husband, our dad and grandpa, a brother, your friend and mentor? The answer is simple. Live your best life like he did his. His life was all about family, friendship, and service. Living his best life took him from Clinton, Mass., where he was born, to South Hadley, where he spent most of his childhood, to North Adams, where he met our mom, to Rutland. Ruthie and Kenny were married in this very church on June 30th, 1962. If Kenny had any doubts about where they would be putting down roots, I think the question was answered when his bride of 3 days insisted that they cut their honeymoon short so that she didn't miss the 4th of July parade. So Kenny put his roots down in Rutland. Ruthie's, of course, were already here. Built their house and started their family. Val came first, then Pam, then Jeff. Then to South Florida, where he enjoyed being part of the Red Sox and Woo Sox organizations, and to the White Mountains of New Hampshire, where he skied and became the president of the board of directors at the Mountain Club. He never did anything halfway. He was either all in or wasn't interested. Not to say that he always needed or wanted to be in charge. Sometimes he was perfectly happy playing supporting roles. However, not too often. Mostly he wanted to guide, strategize, lead, and help with organizations he was involved in, the projects he took on, and the people he was around better. It just naturally happened he always strived to be better, and those around him wanted to do the same. Sort of like his way or the highway, but mostly his way was the right way, at least when it came to business, organizations, and projects. We didn't always like that sentiment at home. Believe me, as teenagers, there were many fights over his highways, but we all made it through. Family. We had a traditional family unit. Mom stayed home to raise us while we were little, and Dad went to work. He told our mother that if the paycheck wasn't enough, then let him know. I don't know if they ever had that conversation, but I don't ever remember feeling like we did not have everything we needed or wanted. He worked hard to provide for us, almost always with 2 and 3 jobs. They got up early for work to raise us, so we were all in bed by 9 p.m. That was the way it was even as teenagers. We didn't have to go to sleep, but the living room TV was turned off. That early to bed and early to rise mentally is still with me, and of course all of us. Even the grandchildren sleep with fans on in their room for the white noise, which probably drives our spouses a little crazy. I know it did my mother. As children, one of our fondest memories was helping Dad on dump day. We had a station wagon, and Dad would put the tailgate down, put the trash barrels on the back of the tailgate, and then needed help securing the barrels so they would not fall out. Here come the kids. We sat on the back of the tailgate, feet dangling over the edge, nothing preventing us from falling off the tailgate. They had no rules about seat belts or car seats then, and the road to the dump was hilly and twisty. We called it the roller coaster road. We would ask Dad to go fast down that road, and we would laugh and have so much fun. I am not too sure why Dad was worried about the barrels falling out and not us kids falling out, but I can still see us riding down the road, and I smile every time. Family camping trips all summer long, although mostly fun, would always start off rocky. We never wanted to be around Dad when the trailer had to be leveled or the awning needed to be erected. All of you know that patience was not really an adjective you would use to describe our father. It almost never went smoothly, and there was a lot of cursing until the tasks were complete. Thank God he had Ruthie. Then, of course, the Budweiser, not Coors Light yet, would come out and he would start to relax and enjoy himself. But those first few hours setting up camp were challenging. He was always at our activities as children, whatever they were, from softball games to cheerleading to soccer games. He carried that through to his grandchildren. He attended every sporting activity, choir or band concert or school play that they participated in. He was very proud of all of us. I didn't realize how proud until I went to his Liberty office one day, and there sprawled out over 2 credenzas were pictures of the entire family at various stages of our lives. And during his retirement party, his boss and co-workers started off their speeches with, "Ken was so proud of his family." He never stopped talking about them. I realized right then that there was nothing more important to him than all of us. We learn to be the people we are because of him and his endless service and sacrifice, the meaning of giving back to the people you love, the community in which you live, and the people you meet along the way, leaving this place better than when you found it. We all went into fields that give back, safety professional, early childhood teacher, and fire investigator. He and my mother set the example for us for that. Friendship and service, we must put these two things together because so many of his friends are because of his service to the town and organizations which he loved dearly. The friendships he found along the way held a special place in his heart. The friendships and services are tied together because without the service, he may not have had all the friendships he was so lucky to have. I believe in what you give is what you get back. I'm reminded of a phrase, friends are flowers in the garden of life, and our dad's garden is full and overflowing, thanks to all of you. Through his love of politics, a very proud Democrat, in case any of you didn't know that, he served on so many boards and committees in town, the Board of Health, the Finance Committee, and as a selectman. He was instrumental in bringing cable to town, having smooth and safe elections, and worked on campaigns for many state representatives, senators, and congressmen and women. He was a die-hard Democrat, and I don't think ever voted away from his political party except once. He voted for Lou Evangelides. He boldly told Lou that I have never voted for a Republican before until you ran for office. I believe it was to let Lou and others know how much respect he had for him, although I believe on several occasions he tried to convert Lou and pull him from the dark side, as they say. Through his tireless dedication and service to the Rutland Volunteer Fire Department and Brigade, he served the department for 25 years and retired as a lieutenant and continued to serve the brigade for 35 more years. When we were young, there were countless dinners, parties, nights, and weekends that were put on pause because the fire tones went off and he had to go fight a fire or respond to an accident. We never questioned where Daddy went or why. We never knew how much danger he was really in. It was just that way at our house. Nothing ever stopped him from answering the call. He was signing on the radio before the garage door was even up. We always seemed to watch him go, but we were never scared or worried about whether he would come home. It was just the way it was. We did not know any other way. Every firefighter family knows that commitment and bond to one another. There are many stories about his leaving for a call, but one winter night when we were all still young, it was snowing like crazy. We must have had 2 feet of snow on the ground already, and the plows had come through, but just barely. And it was slippery, and the banks along the road were high. He backed out of the driveway and into the road, and the tires would not catch, and he rolled into the snowbank. I remember him spinning those tires to get out of the snowbank. Somehow, he got out. We must have gone out to push him because soon he was out and off he went. He was still one of the first to get to the station. Just because he lived so close. the lifelong friends he made and we made as a family through the fire department have been true blessings, and there have been so many wonderful times. Going to musters, watching the brigade float in the 4th of July parade. Don't ever stop that. Camping, and numerous parties all along the way. Jeff, and now Jay, have followed in our dad's and grandfather's footsteps by joining the departments. They say that imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, and Jeff wanted to be just like Dad. Dad helped Jeff realize that there was more than one way to be in the fire service. He did not have to become a full-time firefighter to do that. He could go to college and become an arson investigator, which he did. With 60 years as a member of the brigade, Dad has helped raise hundreds of thousands of dollars for equipment and other things that were outside the department's budget. He started the annual golf tournament, which is usually their biggest fundraiser, and created the blueprint for others to carry the torch, and they named it in his honor this year. It will be strange to not have our father there this year. He was an avid Boston sports fan, in case any of you didn't know that. It didn't matter if it was the Bruins, Celtics, Patriots, or Red Sox. He loved them all, particularly the Patriots and Red Sox. They were always sports on TV or on the radio when he was working in the yard. When we were little, their entertainment was hockey night with friends, dinner, and a game. The men would watch the Bruins, and the women would try new recipes for dinner. What's new? I don't know how often it was, but it seemed like once a week and not always on a weekend. Later, he had season tickets to the Patriots when they weren't very good and sometimes not on TV. It was the thrill of a lifetime when the Patriots went to the Super Bowl in 1986 in New Orleans, and he was able to go and see them play, thinking it might be the only time they would ever get to the Super Bowl. Little did he know, 14 years later, a quarterback drafted 199th would take him, his daughter, and the team to the promised land six times. My love of football was cultivated early on when I got to go to the games with him once a year. I love those memories and the calls we shared after win or loss to discuss the ups and downs of the game. I will miss those calls immensely. His beloved Red Sox led him to the best retirement life. He went to South Florida to watch spring training a few years before he retired with a friend of his who worked as an usher during spring training. He casually asked, how would someone get a job like this? He was told that about a year before you retire, reach out and apply for an usher's job, which he did once he knew he was going to retire. He never heard a thing about it until the night of his retirement party in late January 1999. He got home late from the party, and there was a message on his machine from the Red Sox saying if he wanted a job to call back. He called the next day. They told him he had the job if he wanted. His reply was, when do you want me? The Red Sox told him in 2 weeks, and in 2 weeks, Mom and Dad were on their way to Florida for 7 weeks. Their springs at Lehigh Resort Club worked out perfectly for both Mom and Dad. Dad would go off to the ballpark, enjoy every minute of the games, and Mom would sit around the pool with their friends, reading and socializing. Mom would go to a few games to see him in action. Then several years ago, he started hearing rumblings of the minor league team moving from Rhode Island to Worcester. And he started drooling because he wanted in on that. He would say to anyone who'd listen, they probably will need a local guy that knows the area to help with being ambassador to the city. He wanted baseball to be part of his daily life from February to September, from spring training in Florida to minor league games in Worcester all summer. He followed the buildings of the park and posted its progress nearly every day. Finally, job openings were posted and he got an usher's job. But not only an usher, as a pseudo consultant, they wanted to tap into his experience from JetBlue Park and help set the right procedures at Polar Park. He loved every minute of ushering and the time he spent at JetBlue and Polar Park and all the great people he met there. He could not believe he got paid for doing something he loved and would have done for free. Through the Mountain Club at Loon, he continued to mix his the activities he enjoyed doing, such as skiing, with ways to give back and make a difference. He had learned to ski late in life, but loved it and helped manage Pine Ridge Ski Area, which allowed all of us to learn how to ski, including the oldest grandchildren. He went to Loon to ski and fell in love with the area. And next thing we knew, he and Mom had bought a quarter share at the Mountain Club on Loon. Soon he was interested in the operations of the hotel and had ideas to make it better and was elected to the board of directors. And soon after that became president of the board, which he has held for the past 20 years. Under his leadership, the Mountain Club at Loon became a great destination property. We've enjoyed many family trips there, especially our traditional weekend between Thanksgiving and Christmas, with excursions on the Santa train when the kids were young, to watching the kids ski and snowboard, to annual shopping time in North Conway, and dinners in the restaurant. It's a great place for our family to relax, have fun, and unwind. We look forward to continuing that tradition. My sister and brother-in-law refer to it as their happy place. There you are. My father could not have been prouder and happier about that. Finally, through his passion project, the restoration of the old fire station, Our dad, along with many others, have worked tirelessly to raise the funds needed to restore this building and turn it into a museum and meeting place for the town to be proud of. It is nearly done, and I'm sad that he didn't get a chance to see the grand opening. But when it does open, hopefully soon, I know he will be there and very proud. Our dad always had room for one more. 14 Edson Ave has always been the place where friends and family gather, from pool parties for the fire department, election night celebrations, summer outings for work colleagues, parties for their children and grandchildren's friends, to family celebrations and Sunday suppers. It has been a place for safe harbor, laughter, fun, and love. I have recently realized that most of the parties were Dad's idea, of course, and Mom picked up the work. She went along with it, though, and made it the best place to be. So many wonderful memories and times, and Dad was right in the center of it all. But no matter how many people showed up, everyone knew not to park on Kenny's lawn. Yeah. Dad was not openly demonstrative, but we always knew he loved us and was proud of us. Once he was diagnosed with cancer in December, we knew it was not curable, but that with the treatment, we hoped it could be held at bay. We did not know how long we would have, but we decided as a family to make every day count, and whatever Dad wanted and could do, we would make it happen. Each of us, as it turned out, was going to get one last gift from him. Gift one went to Valerie. It started with going to Florida for spring training. Tom and I had decided last spring that we wanted to get out of the winter here and spend the 7 weeks in Florida to see how we liked it. I work remotely and can work from anywhere, so we rented the same 7 weeks as Mom and Dad. When Mom and Dad were deciding whether they could go, their decision was made a bit easier because they knew we would be there too. We were so fortunate to be there to provide family support during their time in Florida and get that daily time with them that I don't usually get living 45 minutes away. Gift two was for Jeff. A month ago, after a family birthday party, where was at a WooSox going away party for Dad's former boss, and there was no doubt Dad wanted to go and Mom was taking him. By now he was pretty weak, and we were not at all sure how he would do getting inside the restaurant. Jeff decided that he would go with them and make sure that he and my mom got in and out of the restaurant safely. They gave Dad a standing ovation when he walked in and basically held court with all the ushers there. WooSox royalty. Jeff, Dad, and Mom had a wonderfully special time that night, and it turned out to be the last time he would see his WooSox family. Gift number three. Last week, Pam and Dad talked about his family tree and asked if she could start putting the family tree on his side together through her genealogy websites. She has already done Mom's side and had done a lot of work for Dad on the deceased firefighters in town. I think the discussion took place on Saturday, May 20th, and on Sunday, May 21st, when I arrived for a visit. She'd already traced back quite far, and they were discussing it. He was excited about it and eager to learn more. On Wednesday, Dad had planned with Zachary and the Boy Scouts to meet at the rural cemetery to put out the firefighter flags to all the firefighters buried there. He was very weak, but Pam was able to take him. He was determined to go. He pointed out where all the flags had to go and where the graves were located, so every firefighter there had a flag for Memorial Day. That was the last thing he did. That was Pam's gift. I've got one more gift here. Tuesday, last week, Mom and Dad were supposed to meet Dad's sister, brother, and cousin, one of which he had not seen in 20 plus years, for lunch. When he woke up, he did not feel up to traveling. He was so disappointed. Mom called to tell me they weren't going, and that I did not have to meet them. I called Uncle Dick and told him about the situation and stated that although Dad was not up to traveling, he was feeling decent, and he would love to see everyone if anyone wanted to make the trip to Rutland. After lunch, Uncle Dick, Julie, and his cousin Emily and their children went to Rutland had a wonderful visit, which made Dad so happy. And that was their gift. There was a common theme in all the messages, posts, texts, and cards that they all talked about him as being the best leader, friend, and person that they knew. He touched countless people throughout his life, and those privileged to call him husband, dad, grandpa, brother, friend, uncle, mentor, are all better for it. There was nothing sad about his life. It was well lived, it was full of hard work, fun, and laughter and love. Although we will miss him in the evenings around the pool and in the yard, at his computer and in his chair, and miss the genealogy and sports conversations, and at the old fire station and brigade meetings, at the elections, at the ballpark, at the mountain club, and his unwavering strength, love, and support, whenever and wherever you think we think of him, he will be there showing us the way. We all have so many wonderful and special stories and memories. Each is a gift from him to us to treasure and hold in our hearts. Finally, the last of the gifts. Even when time was short and he could not talk, he wanted all of us to know how much he loved us. He took our hands and put them together with his and brought them to his heart. Words would not have been more powerful. Mom was there honoring her husband of 60 years, holding his hand and quietly reassuring him that she and us would be all right and that it was okay to go home. Your job is done, so rest easy now. And I know you are sitting in a beautiful green and mowed lawn watching over all of us. I will love you and miss you forever. Godspeed. Everyone should be so lucky as to live a life like the one Kenny lived.
The families invited or allowed me to invite anyone to come forward and share a memory, if you would like.
So I just had absolutely no plans on speaking, but I just was driven, so I think Uncle Kenny wanted to hear my voice one more time. And you're all thinking, uh-oh, Gail is speaking. I just heard my mother say something about Uncle Kenny being so lucky. Well, interestingly, I was listening to a inspirational speaker last night, and he was saying mathematically that we are all 400 trillion to one unlikely to have this opportunity and live this life. Our chances, Uncle Kenny's chances of being here, and not as a human, as every individual, you, Auntie, and you, Val, and Pam, and Jeff, as people, as individuals, me, and all of you, have your chances to have gotten this opportunity is 400 trillion to one. Just the fact that we have this opportunity is just amazing. The fact that we have this opportunity to be here right now, to be together, to be right here under these circumstances is so unlikely and nearly impossible, but here we are. So I just want to say to everybody here that we're here and we're celebrating being here, and you should just appreciate every single second, the good, bad, and the ugly, because you're so lucky, we're so lucky, I'm so lucky, or blessed, however you choose to look at it. That's all I want to say. And I want to say something to Uncle Kenny, because he always said this to me. And when I leave the church, I'll be sure not to let the door hit me in the ass.
Would anyone else like to come forward? Well, sometimes I don't read lips, so I'm going to step down for a second. I've learned more about Ruth as the days have gone by. She's on top of things, let's put it that way. So anyway, what Ruth reminded me is that though at this point in time you may not have any memories to share, you are invited to Val's restaurant after the cemetery, and there you can share some of what's in your hearts and minds. Oh, yes. I think that runs in the family, if you know. Are we all set? Okay. Just want to make sure I don't forget anything. I do have a final scripture reading to share with you. It is Psalm 139. It has a title called The Inescapable God. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my thoughts. See if there is any wicked way in me, and lead me to everlasting. If you would please rise as you are able and turn to hymn number 227, I Come to the Garden.
Thank you.
Please be seated. I'd like to invite Ruth to come forward.
I don't know if I'll be able to do all this, but I'll try. First, I want to thank all of you for coming today. Such a wonderful, a blessing to see you all here and know what's in your hearts, because it's right there in mine also. And both Kelly and I have been grateful for your friendship and love all these years. I have one final memory to share with you all. 21 years ago, we took a 40th anniversary trip to Alaska, and part of the trip included a cruise. One of the highlights was a nightly entertainment by David Craythorn. He was a pianist and singer. And he played in the lounge, of course. That's where we first saw him. From that entertainment came a song that we've loved for 21 years. It's actually a love song for family and friends, not a romantic thing, just for family and friends. And its title is Amigos para Siempre, which translates to Friends for Life. So here it is for all of you from Kelly and I. It comes from our hearts to yours, and we hope you'll like it. And you can follow along with the words with the handout that was with your program.
I don't have to say a word to you. You seem to know whatever mood I'm going through. Feel as though I've known you forever. You can look into my eyes and see the way I feel and how the world is treating me. Maybe I have known you forever. Amigos para siempre means you'll always be my friend. Amigos para siempre means a love that cannot end. Friends for life, not just a summer or a spring. Amigos para siempre. I feel you near me even when we are apart. Just knowing you are in this world can warm my heart. Friends for life, not just a summer or a spring. Amigos para siempre. We share memories I won't forget, and we'll share more, my friends, we haven't started yet. Something happens when we're together. When I look at you, I wonder why. There has to come a time when we must say goodbye. I'm alive when we are together. Amigos para siempre means you'll always be my friend. Amigos para siempre means a love that cannot end. Friends for life, not just a summer or a spring. Amigos para siempre. I feel you near me even when we are apart. Just knowing you are in this world can warm my heart. Friends for life, not just a summer or a spring. Amigos para siempre. When I look at you, I wonder why. There has to come a time when we must say goodbye. I'm alive when we are together. Amigos para siempre means you'll always be my friend. Amigos para siempre means a love that cannot end. Friends for life, not just a summer or a spring. Amigos para siempre. I feel you near me even when we are apart. Just knowing you are in this world can warm my heart. Friends for life, not just a summer or a spring. Amigos para siempre.
Amigos para siempre means you'll always be my friend. Amigos para siempre means a love that cannot end. Friends for life, not just a summer or a spring. Amigos para siempre. Amigos para siempre.
And now our service of worship and remembrance has come to an end. May you all be blessed and recognize the blessings in your life, that you may lead a full, loving life, one of forgiveness, one of strength. I bid you go in peace.